from Rice University, where we don't have Greek organizations, because our students would think they are equations. It's General Physics 1. Today, Exam 2 Review, featuring Momentum and Energy. Dr. Stenson, also, a top 10 list. And now, a man who figured he would eventually be barred from Hurston Amphitheater, but thought a lawsuit would be involved. Professor Hafner.
A little behind this morning. Things falling apart here. All right. Now I can hear myself. All right. Well, here we go. Things I think are working well enough to keep going. All right, so welcome. This is Exam 2 Review, as you know. And what are we talking about today? Exam 2 Review, yeah. So we're gonna go over momentum and impulse and a little bit of collisions and a little bit of work and energy. Also elastic collisions, not just the perfectly inelastic. And we'll say friction and springs and that stuff for next time. That's fun. So we'll do half of it today, half of it next time. I have 10 problems ready for you. I don't know how long it'll take. We'll see how it goes. Okay, so before we jump in, I'm very concerned about something. Dr. Stenson, we have fallen below 60%, 59% last time. I'm not sure what to do about that. I'm thinking we might need to bring in some young Hollywood actor to do the lectures, maybe that Timothy Chandelier guy or whatever. But I'm not sure what it takes to get people to watch these days anymore. Okay, so I think that's that. Okay, I'm going to start with a quick, before we get into the review, quick clarification from the end of the last lecture. Remember, I did elastic properties of materials very quickly. So we had a column, and we talked about stress and strain. You know, the column is length L, but if you apply a force per unit area, you might be able to extend it by delta L, stretching materials. And we said, well, if you plot the strain on the bottom and the force per unit area stress on the top, you can stretch it. And at first, it just makes a line. And that's really all you need to know. Then I went into stories about what happens after, and plastic and elastic deformation and breaking. And I just want, so for what you need to know just for the exams in this class, it's just at first it makes a line. So, you know, that's why we have our equation F over A equals Y. The elastic modulus is the slope of that line, delta L over L. And how to use that and how to think of it in terms of a spring constant, all that stuff we did. All the crazy stuff after was really just for fun, except one thing. I'm going to let you have this little imaginary pretend world where it's just a line until it breaks. The point where it breaks is important. It's called the tensile stress. Is that the right word? Tensile strength. The tensile strength is given in pascals because it's the y-axis value where it breaks. So in reality, a bunch of bad things happen to the curve and then it breaks, but just in our simplistic intro physics, we'll say it's a nice line and then it breaks. Don't worry about the weird stuff. So from that, you know, you can figure out how long could it elongate, you know, how much strain could it take before it breaks, and how much stress before it breaks and all this stuff. So that's really the parts you need to know. I'm sure all the last minute ranting about other things made you nervous. Yeah, because I tried to do it too fast, ran out of time. I sort of lost all concept of time in this little room. I've been in here too long. Okay. I hope there's people here. I don't even know. Okay, oh yeah, there's And I need the chat. I'm going to see the chat, and I need to see me. I'm just looking at Dr. Stinson, and that's fine. I need to be able to see what's happening.
Jason, how would you like me to direct questions? If people ask questions during this review, are you going to be looking at the Q&A board frequently?
I'm just going to look at the chat.
The chat, okay.
Yeah, so you do the Q&A.
I'll put some questions in the chat.
Somebody has sort of a... Yeah, if you have one that you think I could answer in real time. And also, we're going to do something, I think. Oh, no, the way we're going to do the practice problems, I'm going to use the chat, not the Q&A. Okay, so lots of questions coming in. When to use? Yeah, we'll do some of that. One is being removed. Yeah, I removed it this morning. So 11.03, I made the change, the deadline for it, like 2 weeks from now. So it's no longer due tomorrow because it's something we'll cover with. What time's the exam on Friday? So we'll do the same thing. It'll be the same, like a window. It's technically 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Houston time, but I'll probably open it at like 6:30 and close it at 9:30 or whatever I did last time. I don't remember. I believe we'll have it open for 3 hours and you have 2 hours to take it. So 7 p.m. But I'll probably open it early to give you a little freedom to get ready. Well, the exam cover stuff we did before the first midterm too. There will be no problem that is explicitly about the first part. They're all focused on the middle material, but of course, you know, it mentions force and position and velocity, right? So of course, since it all builds, yeah, but there's no problems that are just, oh, this is a first section problem. I'm not sure what 11.07, that's an office hours question. I can't do that live because I don't actually have them all in front of me. Okay, so I got these 10 problems. And what we're going to do is first do a quick review of what each section is about, and then the 10 problems. And if I do this, you're all going to be okay. We're all going to do fine on the exam, and we're going to save you from this torturous exam. My therapist says I have a messiah complex, but I forgive her. No. Okay, so the first section was on momentum. We defined it. Momentum is P equals mv. And that's it. A mass moving at V equals MV. Okay, but then the other next concept was a force for a time can change momentum. So the change is important, momentum, and that's called impulse. All right, so that's where we have the three equal sign equation. Because the impulse equals that force times that time. You apply a Newton for a second, you apply a Newton second. And that happens to be equal to the change momentum. So really, this is the equation. For some reason, it has its own name. It doesn't have to. But the force you apply for a time equals the change of momentum. And of course, this might be an integral. If the force were changing with respect to time, it'd be an integral of f dt. You're not going to do a lot of complicated integrals on this exam. You might have to look at one and do the area under the curve and do some geometry. And of course, remember, in a problem, you want to think of this as the momentum final after this force interaction minus the momentum initial at the beginning, before the force interaction. And I'm going to, in addition to all this, I'm going to show you what the equation sheet looks like. I haven't sent it around yet because I got to edit it. But let's see. So momentum is that, impulse is that, and then for an isolated system, momentum is conserved. Right? This is an important one. And conserved is a fancy physics word that means it doesn't change. We often write it delta p equals zero. Of course, the way you might use that more often is that the final momentum after some interaction or process equals the initial momentum. And then so we got momentum, we got impulse, we got conservation. And now the other one we did in this section because you don't need energy yet, was the perfectly inelastic collision. Don't worry about why it's perfect. Just inelastic collision. It's the one where things stick together. Things stick together. We did these because you don't need to conserve energy. So we did these before we had talked about energy. And it's the case where if you have mass one moving in the initial towards mass two, and you ask yourself, what happens? Well, it would have to happen over here when they're combined. How do they move? And that's the case where the V final equals M1 over M1 plus N2. M1 over M1 plus M2 V initial. So only one equation. We don't deal with a case when this one's also moving. But you could do it if you had to. I mean, because this is just directly a case of conservation momentum. MVI times M1 equals VF times M1 plus M2. Really, it probably barely needs its own special equation. So if we look at the equation sheet, so I'm just going to show it real quick because I haven't sent it around. Here's what you'll have, right? P equals MV, conserved, J, written both as an integral, that integral. I don't equate it to delta P. You'll have to remember that the impulse is delta P. Oh, no, there it is. The impulse is delta P. Okay, cool. And then the collisions are in a different spot here. I will be posting this soon. Two masses perfectly elastic. Oh, inelastic, there it is. Yes, the inelastic equation. So I think this equation sheet uses knots as initials, but you know, maybe I'll update that. But I just wrote the entire exam and I'm wasting it on these practice problems. Wasting it. Okay, here we go. So the way I was thinking we could do the practice problem is, let's see, that I'll flash it up here. I'll read it in case you can't see it for some reason. I'll decide if I'm drawing a diagram or you have to do the diagram on your own. And then you'll work on it and put your answer in the chat. Oh, I'm looking at the Q&A. Put your answer in the chat. You can just send it to me if you want, if you're shy, or maybe that's even better because then people won't see your answer. That'll give me some idea, like almost everybody's done with this one and no one got it right or something. Give me some sort of idea of how you're doing. Okay. All right, here we go. Problem one. Here we go. Looks something like this. Shh. Oh, there. Yeah. Oh, I put them on the wrong side. Let me go over here. I can't. They're too far away. I can't read them. All right, so two pucks are on an air table, so they can move without friction. Puck one moves along the x-axis at V, two is at rest. Sounds like we're setting up for a nice collision here. After they collide, one stops, and two moves at 45 degrees from the axis. How fast does it move? It means puck two, yeah. How fast does puck two move? Multiple choice, think about that one, see what you can get. Let's see if I can fix my screen problem here. And if you're doing it, don't look at the chat. People will be posting their answers in the chat. So I need to close it. All right, yeah, okay, got a few answers here, yeah, a little bit of everything. It spelled bad for a second. It spelled bad. All right, let's look at it. We've got a range of answers here. So you probably want to start the drawing, right? One moves along the x-axis. Just trying to hint to you there that it's in 1D, right? And it was moving at V, right? So we don't need a subscript like that. that. And M2 was like this, right? And is it rest after they collide? No. And this is at rest. Right? So after, it's saying that M2 goes off in that direction. And we're asking what happens to M1. So, and the choices look like, you know, and they would be nicely for, oh, shoot, sorry. Yeah, you get the idea. Two is like that, and then after two goes off like that, what does one do? Okay. Okay, so these were written if the answers were chosen if you were trying to do different things. Like maybe you're trying to conserve momentum. Maybe you said, well, you started with M1V, so over here we have maybe M2 just has like square root of 2V, that component, if it's 45 degrees, so this one must be like what's left over or something like that, you know, 1 minus square root of 2V. All these things, all those answers are wrong, okay? Those are incorrect answers I made up by just different guesses of what you might think about, but it's really D. This situation is impossible. So the idea is you draw that. Wait, I had an M1 stop, right? Okay. Yes, M1 stop, yeah. After you draw that, you should look at it and realize if puck one stops and all I had was horizontal momentum, there's no way I can gain vertical momentum. Like the only way that could have happened is if puck one either had some initial y momentum or went down. Right, if puck one went down, then the vertical momentums could cancel. But you can't, so this would have created vertical momentum. And you can't do that. So basically that little cartoon can't conserve momentum. That was basically the idea. Okay. So sometimes the weird zero whatever answer will be correct. Okay. Yeah. So that's why it's good to draw. You'll notice that one more if you draw it, because you'll see, wait, how could that go up and conserve momentum? So right out of the gate, we have a 2D problem. So yeah, okay, hold on. It's gonna get wild, here we go. Let's look at the second one. Okay, new problem. Futuristic train, let me get over here, glides on a track carrying a large amount of sand. Since it's frictionless, it has no motor, it's just gliding. But then the sand starts to leak out. So what will make happen? So I think this one's imagined enough that I won't draw it for you. Just think about it for a minute. Got a lot of A's here. Oh, I guess I shouldn't tell you what I'm getting, what people are saying. Bit of everything. Let's see, a little bit of everything. So this one is actually a tricky one. Yeah, well, you're not doing calculations again. So this is a tricky concept I wanted to go over real quick. So say we have the train, and it can be on a frictionless track, I guess. And well, it's not water, it's sand. That's sand. So it has some big mass, and it's going at V. Okay. So let's let some of that sand start to leak out. If the sand falls out, based on sort of what we learned about kinematics and things, does the sand have any velocity this way? Yes, it does. So the sand is still moving at V. So since the train is moving, the big MV, and the sand is moving at V, then what happens is when you leak, this becomes big M, minus a little bit of MV. So that's probably what making you think some of the input A, you want to speed up because we have a conserve momentum. But this sand kept moving. So basically you get your little momentum from the sand and stays in there. So the answer is C. Right. So this isn't going to speed up because the sand now. Now there's some ground here. and the sand hits the ground, and yeah, place pushes a little forward velocity on the Earth or something like that. But that's not what we're worrying about. We're just worrying about the terrain it's in. Okay. So the one way to think about it is whenever you're moving and you release something, the thing you release goes at the same speed you're moving, which we did things like that in kinematics. Another way to think about it is this would only speed up if it got a little impulse. There would have to have been some action-reaction force between the sand that came out and the train. And if you just drop something, there's no kick that you just release. That's sort of just saying why they move forward to you. Okay. So that was a little tricky. You'll see. One person, I know your gut says A, but it might be C. Okay. Don't trust your gut. Let's see. Okay. Now I'm going to erase. I was going to fix something. I forgot. Let me erase this answer. And y'all think about this one. This one. So now this is one where I know that you. The symbolic ones are tricky. We don't do enough symbolic ones. So see if you can do this one symbolically. I mean, really do it. Don't just, you know what I mean? Do you need to draw it, or does that, let's see, was I going to draw this one? Let me read it again. Three equal masses on a frictional surface stick together when they collide. Should be arranged and moving a shell. Oh, yeah. What does it sound like? Let's see, yeah, I guess I'll draw this one for you. Yeah, okay, yeah, so no, this one's critical to draw, yeah, sorry. I stepped away for a minute. M. So three equal masses. And these are going, this one's going at V1, and this one's going at V2. So V1, V2, M in the middle at rest. And then, now you answer the question, how fast are they going when they all stick together? There you go. Getting lots of B and lots of C. And I now realize, in a way, they're both right. Depends on how you're doing the math. So we'll talk about that. A very small way they could both be correct. Be a stretch to me. D correct. All right, let me tell you what I mean. Lots of B's, lots of C's, some D's, a little bit of everything. Okay. So it is an inelastic collision problem, things just crashing into each other, sticking together. The one tricky thing about it, you could say, is I have my initial state. Clearly, this is moving, this is moving, this is at rest. I can calculate the momentum of that. But for my final state, do I need to do this collision and have these two collide with this one? That's why I drew these closer together, to let you think, do I need to do that? But actually you don't, because these two are then going to collide with this one. They're all going to be together. And the momentum has to be constant at every point. So you can just conserve momentum here, and then you can conserve momentum once they're all stuck together and going whatever speed they're going. If you do the intermediate step, you'll get the same answer. You'll just be more likely to make some little mistake. So, you know. Okay, so what is the answer? So let's look at the initial momentum and the final momentum. Okay. So the initial momentum, here we go. You say, well, it's 1D. We could call that the x-axis if we want. And you have to add them as vectors. So that's what I mean, the ambiguity on these answers. Are those Vs vectors, or are they vector components? That's the question. So the exam will be more clear. Here, though, they're not bold. There's no arrow above them. So those are vector components, which basically means the direction is going to be in the sign, is how I would think of this. So if you're writing it that way, which we usually do in one dimension, you would say that the initial momentum is, just to make sure my notes make sense, is m times v1. And you say, okay, that's positive, minus m times v2. And I know that one's going that way, so I'm going to write it as negative. Probably I would have been more careful to say plus x, and I would have said the v's in the answer are vector components. Use negative to indicate left. Because you could also say, so if we're going to do it with components, if we're going to do it with vectors, you may have written m v1 plus m v2, right? That's the momentum. That is true. But you do actually know this one is backwards, so I would write it that way. Then you would say the final is 3m times whatever v you're looking for. If you're writing it this way, you just write the component as v. And then you solve it, and if v1 is bigger than v2, you know that it'll end up going this way because the number will come out positive. And if v1 is less than v2, you know it'll end up going this way because the number is negative. That's kind of how you do it if you're doing it with components. If you're doing it this way, 3mv vector, okay? So anyway, let's do it this way, and then we cancel all the m's, and this is why it's 1/3 v1 minus v2. All right, so that's the answer I intended, that's b. But yeah, if these had vector symbols on them, it would be this one. 1/3 v1 plus v2. Okay. Now you may be saying, this is annoying. How can there be two different answers? And there really aren't. It's really just notation. If we did this as a numerical problem, okay, and I said, this one's going 1 meter per second that way, and that's going 2 meters per second that way, then when you actually went to get a number for the answer, you would have to put in minus m2 i hat. Right? You would eventually have to acknowledge the negative if we were doing this numerically. Okay, so we were careful on the exam not to leave ambiguities like that. Yeah. But anyway, that's what I think maybe led some of you to see. Okay, cool. All right, let's see. I won't do it in two steps because I want to make sure we have plenty of time to do everything. All right, number four. What time is it now? What are we doing here? Number four. Okay, so number four is one where you have to go a little bit further than what you've ever done before. Yeah, that's the one. So let's see how we do with that. Four, like that. I'll erase. You read it. I assume y'all can see it. I think the text is big enough. Yes, yes. Let's see. So two grand pump, but it'll come back soon. The simple force jump group shown. Yeah. So it is, looks like time, force, and it looks like we're assuming this ideal thing where it's 1 newton for 100 milliseconds. that is your curve, a constant 1 newton from 0 to 100 milliseconds. Now you can do it. I think. All right, well, I think I'm just gonna retire and stop teaching because I thought this was the one that no one would know how to do. Everyone got it right. And I know everyone isn't answering, so I'm still obviously gonna walk through it, but it's just, I always find it humorous. I have no idea what's going on. It's like I'm not even teaching the class. All right, let's walk our way through this here. So we had a ping pong ball with mass 2.7 milligrams, 2.7 grams, 0.0027 kilograms, right? And it was flying along at 30 meters per second. So, you know, when a ping pong ball hits a wall, it like hits it. And then you've seen the cool videos, whole websites of these, crushes, and then it pops back out. So it's like this collision. And we're saying this collision lasts 100 milliseconds. Okay? So that's what this plot is. This plot is the force the wall applies to the ball. And usually what's happening inside this curve, we say, this magic, mysterious contact force is instantaneous. You know, don't even try to understand it. So that's why this one, that, let's think about it a little bit. Is there any way to know when what I asked, when it stops moving? You could say, well, it must be in the middle. It must spend half its time going in and half its time going out. So that's why I pointed out that it comes about with a different speed. If you had something that went in at 30 meters per second, came out at 30 meters per second, then yeah, probably it's gonna be some symmetric thing, it's gonna be in the middle. But what we can do is think about what's happening within this curve. Like if you take a certain amount of time and get the impulse from that time, that much has changed the momentum. And if you go a little bit further, it's changed the momentum that much more. If you go a little further, it's changed a little more. And if you go all the way, that 1 times 100, or 1 newton times 0.1 seconds, must be the change of momentum all the way from this 30 to this whatever it is. We haven't given the number. Okay. So therefore, we should be able to figure out where in here have we stopped it, because we know the change of momentum. It goes from initial to final to zero. All right, so delta P is final zero minus 0.0027 times 30. So you get that the delta P that you need is, I guess it must be 0.081 newton seconds. If we multiply those two, 0.027 times 30, zero differences, that's the difference. So 0.081 newton seconds. And you say, at what point has this caused 0.081 newton seconds? Well, it's 1 newton times whatever you have here, right? So it's 0.081 seconds. So anyway, that's why 81 milliseconds. But the key is that you can think a little bit about what's inside this curve. Not just the total thing it does, but you can think about, if you know the initial momentum, drives it to zero, that's the point at which it's done. And here the area was easy because it was just a rectangle. You know, if we get into triangles, then you have to know the area of a triangle. That's from the formula sheet. Okay, yeah, so let's see. Oh, let's see, we have some questions about that one. Yeah, one person asked about how to do with that, how it rebounds. That's a good question. I could also ask, how fast does it rebound? And then you could have used the full 100 milliseconds times the one to figure out how fast it comes back.
Yeah.
But that's the key, is you're looking for the rebound because you're trying to calculate a delta P. But the one other thing you know is when it stops. So you can have delta P there too. So the answer was E, yes, E, 80 milliseconds, 81. It depends on how you round it. All right, so now I have a new topic. Sorry, my notes got in order, which is nice. That was four. Oh yeah, now we have occlusion problems. Let's see. It's only 10:17. Let's talk about the, let's do the occlusion problem and then we'll do the break and then we'll open there. Okay. How do we do it? Okay. Okay. Four. And isolated. These are meant to just be kind of reminders of multiple masses. Right. Okay, so here are some rules. The position of the center of mass does not move. Now here's an important part. If initially at rest, right, so these are the ones where you're standing on something and you start walking and it slides behind you. Because nothing was moving. So really you could also say the velocity of the center of mass remains constant because it was zero. So that's remained zero. And if the velocity is zero, then it couldn't have moved. Or you could also say the center of mass moves at constant V.
Dr. Hafner? The text from the last question is still on the screen, so we can't see what you're writing on the top. Can you remove the?
I know.
There you go.
Oh my God, thank you. The center, okay, so, yeah, well, hopefully you heard me saying it, right? Isolated system, many masses, position of the center mass doesn't move, it's initially at rest, or center mass moves a constant V if initially moving. So we've thought a little bit about each kind of case, and we tied them to Newton's laws. So this is usually the person walking on the cart or the boat. This is usually like a collision problem. Masses hitting, we ask about what the center of mass is. So that's just a reminder of how these sort of center of mass problems work. Also remember that the position of the center of mass in 1D is 1 over big M, the total mass. Well, it's the position of each mass, right? M1, X1, M2, X2, blah. And the velocity of the center mass is 1 over the total mass times the velocity of each mass, 2, blah, blah. So it's really simple, just add those up. Okay. And the reasons, we got into the reasons related to Newton's laws. We don't care about the reasons at this point. We just need to be able to do the problems. Okay. So that's your little review. Let's do one problem like this. Uh-oh. I haven't erased yet. Shore, solids that friction, you walk to the other end of the sled, the one closer to the shore, trying to get to the shore. By the time you walk there, can you just step onto the shore? We have to jump onto the shore. How far is the shore? Y'all think about that while I close this one. A little loud. Did y'all stop mowing? Cares what the campus looks like right now. We're trying to get the visitors to stop coming. As a former lawn care professional, I'm confident that they can handle me yelling at them. All right, let me think about it. This is an American. Okay, so I know a lot of you are still working on it, but in the interest of time, I'm going to go ahead and run through it. So we're going to run out of time, get all these done. Okay. Let's see, this side. Here we go. Draw here. Here you are at the back of a 4-meter sled, right up against the shore that you're trying to escape the perilous ice. Okay. And the idea, of course, is if you walk forward, things can go backwards, okay? So one key, so this is a case where we have two objects. So it's one of these collision problems where you're tracking the center of mass, because at first you're not moving. So you're not moving, you walk to the end, you're not moving, and where do things end up? So the idea is you have to set it up so that the center of mass doesn't move. So in these, you always need an axis and start putting things on the axis, and you want to put something at the origin to make it easier. So I would put the origin here where you are. And then you can think about you move forward in X, the sled's going to move backward in X. It's going to be good, okay? So the center of mass at the beginning is what? It's a 1 over the total mass, 70 kilograms. You're 60 and the mass of the sled is 10. Yeah. And then your position, 0 times your, is irrelevant, your 60, so just 0. That's why I put you at the origin. Plus the position of the center of the thingy, of the sled. Remember, if you give yourself this uniform object, in terms of its center mass, you say it's at the center of the object. Right, so we say this thing sits at 2. So it's 2 times 10, its mass. Okay. There you go. So you actually have a number for the center of mass. You actually know where it is, right? It's 20 over 70, it's 2/7 of a meter. And you might say, but how is this? Because if I put this at the origin, this doesn't contribute. But it did contribute. It didn't contribute here, but it contributed here. Right, so your heavy mass does pull the center mass that way. So it's right there, 2/7. So there's your center mass, okay? So the first step usually in these is just some numerical calculation. Now, let's calculate it again after things move. And this is the harder part, because you have to make up a variable. You have to have the courage to just say, I'm gonna make up a variable. I know this thing's gonna go backwards. I know that's what's gonna happen. I don't know how much, I'm gonna call it X. It's gonna move back to negative X. And that happened because I walked all the way to the front. And how far away is the shore? That's really the question. So remember, there's always a step in these. Make something move. Okay, so the new center mass, 1 over 70. The masses didn't change. Where are you? You walked forward 4, but the thing moved backwards X. So you are at, I'm going to go ahead and write 4 minus X. That was it, right? Yes, 4 minus X times 60. And what about the sled? Where is the sled? Is it at minus X? No, it moved back by minus X. It is at, it was at 2, right? So it's at 2 minus X times 10. There we go, yeah. So that has to equal 2/7. That's meters, by the way, if you think that's mass. All right. So now you just have algebra. Okay. And you solve for X. So 10, 2, 1, 20, I think. 2, oh, did I mess that up? I don't know. In the end, you get X equals 0.57 meters, unless I'm X enough. But everybody else seems to get the same answer. So. All right. So this thing moved back 0.5 meter. And you say, I'm done. But now you got to actually get the answer. How far do you have to jump? Wait, did I move that 2 in the wrong way? Hold on. 2 over 1 over 10. I feel like that's a 1 over 20. Okay, let me do this explicitly. I'm worried I messed this up. If anybody wants to, let's see. If people in the chat, oh my goodness. Explain again why the train, oh, I can't do the train. If something is moving and it drops something, the something that it drops goes the same speed as it's moving. That's just property of the universe. So there's the answer in the chat. Okay, now, I don't know, I'm just freaking out because I feel like I, 72 over 7, so I did some algebra here, and I made that 10, and I made that 1. Oh, and then I brought this over here. I did it right. Okay, yeah.
Okay, yes.
Okay, I know what I'm doing, okay. So yeah, so we said 60, that's 240, and that's 20. And 240 and 20 is 260. bring the 20 back, it's 240, all right? So that's all the non-x values. And this is minus 60x and minus 10x, minus 70x, bring the other side, 70x. And then, wait a minute, is that wrong again? 70x equals 240. X is 3.43. Thank you. Okay, this is not right. Okay. I knew something was wrong. Okay, there's X. I have two things labeled X in my notes. Tuition refunds, I'll send out around a form. I'll send a form around. Okay, so this thing's going to move back by 3.43 meters. Does that make sense? Yeah, it's because you weigh a lot more than this thing. So the heavy thing, usually, you know, the light thing will just move under you. So it moves back, not really how you drew it. So your intuition wasn't quite right. So the next question, though, that wasn't what you were asked. You were asked, how far do you have to jump? Well, because of the way we set this one up, how far you have to jump ends up being X, okay? Because how far, because let's see, if this moved back 3.43, what's left is 4 minus 3.43, but you have to jump 4 minus that. So you end up having to jump the same distance that it moved back, okay? And it's just because I put this right up against the shore, okay? So it really depends on, do we want to catch people in that or not? If we had said this end is like 2 meters from the shore, then there's yet another step after this to get the actual answer. So people that forgot to do that. But I set it up in a way that if you just say, oh, X, that must be the answer, then you get it right. All right. So it was D, 3.43. You did something else. Yeah, I can't do detail. These are, I can't interpret detail questions. Okay. So the next thing we'll talk about is mechanical energy. But I will do the break real quick. And we have a programming change. So we're not going to do stupid physics tricks. Since we're desperate to find some way to get the ratings back up, I have a poll for you. So don't write anything naughty in the poll, and everything will be fine. All right, I'll see you in 5 minutes. This is kind of feeling like Tuesday. Next Tuesday. Very, Dr. Stenson, the people have spoken. I am ready to hand over the microphone, although now you're being beat by Ratatouille. That's not a person, that's like a movie, isn't it? Or is there a person named Ratatouille now? I don't know. I used to know stuff. There was one chat question about where did this come from? So that was me just doing a bunch of algebra on this. So this whole final center mass equals initial center mass, 2/7, do a bunch of algebra and it gets down to that. That's what it was, okay. Seriously, is Ratatouille a person? I need to know. It's a movie, right? The rat's name was Remy, right? Is it Remy? No, it wasn't Remy. The rat.
Yes,
Remy. Thank you. I know stuff. Thank you. A rat named Remy. Oh, wow. Okay. So much validation. I can't let Dr. Stenson have it. I have to have. Okay. Now, here we go. Dr. Stenson, I'll bring all this crap to your house over the break. Mechanical energy. All right. I sort of oversimplified this, but then I'm going to show you what's on the equation sheet that has kind of everything. But just to remind ourselves kind of what we were talking about, mechanical energy was our kinetic and potential energy. And, you know, when it's mechanical, this is just gravitational and spring. If you have gravity and springs in the problem, okay? For an isolated system with no friction. That's that. And now this is a new point. For an isolated system with no friction, it's conserved, right? That's the idea. Then we have E. Well, okay. I mean, yes, that's true. Yes, okay. Emac then must equal the kinetic plus the gravitational spring. So let's remember what these formulas are. Of course, 1/2 mv² the energy of motion. Ug, mgh, or y. It's got to be in the vertical direction. And u spring, 1/2 kx². And somebody asked earlier about 1/2 kx² and f = -kx. And we're going to look carefully at those in one of these problems. So we're about to do a couple of spring problems. But really, the reason they're different is one is a force and one is an energy. This is in newtons, this is in joules. And then you may also remember that if we want to convert between them, you use work, right? If you're going between K and you do something or you change one, you have that thing called work, FD or F dot D, if they're not parallel, or serious problems, integral of F dot DX. Okay, we usually just hope they're FD. And then finally, this is conserved. Delta E mag equals zero. This is assuming it's isolated and there's no friction and everything. But you can think of, there's two ways to use this. You can write all your deltas, the delta K plus the delta U's. I'll put some language on there, equals zero. The U's, two of them. Or you can say K final plus U final equals K initial plus U initial. Or you can use your intuition. So we've talked a little bit about, just think about it. But you know, the formulas are the safer way to go. This next problem, well, you're gonna get it wrong because your intuition. Although with that hint, maybe I'll get it right. Although then again, the last one wasn't 0.57. I think I misled you a little bit on how I drew it. You know, if you go through the numbers in the drawing, then at the end, the origin was here. It moved back by 3.43, right? And the original distance to the shore was 4. So 0.57 was this distance. All right, so that'll be how to jump back to the origin. It's 4 - 0.57. Okay, I don't know why I answered that right in the middle. I don't know if you could see it. Oh, good, yeah, you can see it. Okay. Now we're going to bring up the next. Six. And I'm actually going to read it, see if I need to draw it. You shoot a toy gun vertically. The bullet mass M is initially pushed down a distance D against the spring, spring constant K. Bullet reaches a height H above the end of the barrel. Yeah. So, yeah, I guess I probably should draw this one. Okay, so here's your toy gun like this. The spring, so you push this thing down, like here's the bullet. Spring is all wrapped up in there, and that's D. And then it shoots up, and there's H. So we're setting up like that. There's D. Yeah, so just that H is above the top of the gun. And D is how far down you push the thing. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, so spring constant K. Mass M, push it up, yeah. Okay, so then the question was, yeah, which of the following is an expression for H? So we'll start working on that. I think you saw what I meant, and I'll redraw it where it's not on top of the letters. Okay. I said this one would be tricky. Right, I think we're gonna keep going. If you're working on it, not a lot of answers, I know you're thinking about it. I've seen a lot of D's, and a lot of D's change to E's, and it is E. So that's good that you change it to E. Because, so this one, the trap you fall into, not that we lay traps for you, is you'd say, oh, well, it's just 1/2 kx² equals mgh. Right? I've converted my spring potential into my gravitational, I've converted my spring potential into my gravitational potential. So because it's at rest here, and it's at rest here, so there's no kinetic to keep up. That would be the intuitive way to keep up with it. So I clamped it down by D, and it went up by MGH. But, so the one thing to remember is when you're doing spring problems vertically, then the gravitational potential does change throughout the spring's compression. Okay. Now, you know, in a real setup, it might be that is really small, you know, compressed this much and shoots way up in the air, so it's something you ignore. But, you know, we didn't say that by any means here. So the way to fix the intuitive method would be to say, no, the origin is here. And therefore, it goes up to a height mgh plus t. Now let's just solve that real quick and show that the answer is E. So then you get, oh, we're solving for H here. All right, so you get 1/2 KD squared minus MGD, all right, equals MGH. And you divide through by the MG. And then you get the thing that looked tempting at first over 2MG minus D. Yeah, the MG is canceled. So yeah, it's E. So you could do intuition. You could fix your intuition. You might find this like, why does it matter where I put the origin? Can I put the origin? I want to put the origin there. Right? I want golden ticket now. And for that, what you would do is, or if you want, I'm also going to do it by conserving energy. I think then we'll write it more formally, and you'll see that wherever you put this origin, you can move things around, doesn't matter. Let's do it by just conserving mechanical energy. Let's see. K final plus U gravitational final plus U spring final equals K initial plus U gravitational initial plus U spring initial. All right, so this is a problem where it's not moving. Right, it starts at rest, ends at rest. So we don't care about those terms. And then, you know, just where do you want to put zero? Let's do it my way, put zero down there. Then the initial gravitational here is zero. Spring initial, this is your 1/2 kd squared. Spring final is zero because it's been released. And now what is your gravitational final? It's that d plus h, mg. So that's what I just did in energy form. What if you chose though, I'm going to put the I want to put zero there. You can do that. That's still zero. U gravitational final is now just mgh, like you wanted it to be. Spring final is zero. Okay. K initial zero. U gravitational initial. Aha! Oh, it's not at zero. It's at minus d minus mgd. And spring initial plus 1/2 kd squared. All right. So now you bring the algebra, right? You bring this over here, and it's just mgh plus d. Right. So don't ever repeat the origin. You have to acknowledge that while the spring is pushing it up, it's changing its gravitational potential. So sometimes we put weird looking ones there just to make something up to have E letters. Sometimes it's the actual answer. So, yeah. Okay. Yes. That one generated 3 new messages. Yes. Yes, everyone changed from D to E. Good job. Okay. All right. Now, let's look at. Okay, so that was an example. We'll probably finish on this one because this is tricky. That was an example looking at gravitational potential from different sort of points of view. Different zeros, but remember springs aren't quite that simple. So springs, there's not this like linear and you can put zero anywhere. Springs are really zero when the spring is natural in terms of their potential energy. So noodle on this one for a minute. Let me see if I need to draw anything here. You push 2 kilogram mass 60 centimeters against a 3000 newton meter spring. The mass is released and the spring shoots it forward. How much work does the spring do on the mass for the first 20 centimeters? So this is a case where you think about work a little bit. You don't really use conservation. You just think you change something's energy. How much did you change it? Or you can do a work calculation. We'll probably do it both ways. Let's see how you do it here. I'm way too slow today. I mean, I made too many problems is what I mean to say. I didn't go too slow. Don't mind me, I'm just gonna start drawing a little bit. This was hard. Hard one. And we're down to 6 minutes. So I think I'm just going to jump in and do it. Sorry. So my timing today is not great. Okay. So two ways to do it. One way is sort of an energy trick. You can do it with energy. You can, I mean, hopefully you get the idea. It's about, it's related to the potential energy of the spring. You know, you've put a bunch of potential in the spring. And then by the time you get to 40, you've released some of it. The way to, so you could think, what's the potential energy here and the potential energy here in the spring? And whatever you lose in the spring, you must have put into the kinetic on the bullet. So you must have done that much work on the bullet. Okay, so one sort of energy trick to think of that way. If you wanted to do the intuitive thing, somewhat intuitive thing I just said formally, you would say, let's think of the bullet as isolated. Then the external work you do is to change the kinetic energy on the bullet. But I want to do this with the spring's potential. So you say, I could also think about, what about the spring bullet isolated? Well, then you'd say zero is delta U spring plus delta K. Okay, so even though you thought of these two different ways, you can kind of see that if you could calculate the delta K from the spring potential difference, then that's the same as the external work. Okay, so that's kind of one way to get there. Let's just do that real quick. Let's see. So what is delta K? The change in kinetic energy. Well, it better come out positive. It's so K final minus K initial is delta K. U final minus U initial is negative U final minus U initial, right? So the sign will work out. So it's minus, the final is 1/2 K times the 60 squared minus 1/2 K times the 40 squared, the K being 3000, okay? This is not what I was doing in my notes exactly here. So if you work all that out mathematically, you get that this is 540 and this is 240. All right, let's see, delta K is delta, yeah. So you end up getting minus 300 joules, okay? So you lose 300 joules because the spring did positive 300 joules of work. So really all you're supposed to do is figure out how much potential the spring have, 540. How much does it have here? 240. What's the difference, 300. So that's just the answer. Now, if you don't like all this energy switching around, you can also just straight up do the work calculation. So let me just flash that at you real quick. But then, see, it gets very confusing with getting the negative sign right, okay? Because really, if you want to do it with forces and work, like somebody was asking at the beginning, you'd probably make an axis, make the end the origin, because that's the natural length, you know, and say F equals minus KX. Minus, well, let's leave it with K for now, okay? And does that make sense? Yes, because these are negative X's. All right, so I've got negative 60, I got a big force, negative here, positive force, negative 40, positive force. So that's right. So then the work equals the integral of minus kx dx, so it's minus 1/2 kx squared. And we're going from minus 60 to minus 40, and minus 60, minus 40. Right, and you know, you do all this stuff, and basically you plug in minus 40 here, squares, and you get minus 240 minus, and then minus 540. And you see that's minus 240 plus 540, 300. Okay, it's just be very easy to script a negative sign. But when all the answers are positive, if you got minus 300, you probably know what to do. All right, so I rushed through that one. Everything else is about little equations. I'll do them next time, and we'll be in good shape. Okay. But you need to convert centimeters to meters. Yeah, I did. So I did when I converted, got those into joules. Yeah, so those were all converted centimeters. All right, it's 11. We're done. I'm going to leave, from now on, I'm going to leave the chat open for like 5 minutes for quickie questions, logistic questions. I'm not going to come back to the board because then people will think the class is still happening. Okay. But I will sit here on the text. Okay. So I'll see you Thursday with more review.